But another aspect of prayer that we all need to learn is the aspect of in prayer, not only we communicate with God and talk and fellowship and worship, but we also have dreams and have visions. Dreams and visions is not something you get when you eat too much pizza, and visions is not something you get when you're spacing out in church or in the classroom. Dreams is a goal a person has inside, a faith they have inside. It's this thing that they are waiting, expecting, seeing, thinking, feeling, and eventually speaking. And we all actually have dreams, whether you realize it or not. Every person in this room has faith. Not all of us have positive faith. Faith is like a car. It can go D or R, depending on where you push it. Faith can be going in reverse or it can go in drive. Every person here actually has a vision. The only problem is some of the visions we have in our mind are not the visions we want to see in our life. And so when you come to prayer, many times a prayer becomes a place where you just tell God your needs instead of sharing with God your dreams and your visions. We all have dreams and visions. We all have expectations and anticipations. And the question has to be what kind of dream and what kind of goal you actually have. Like the story goes about one woman who was constantly paranoid that any noise at night in her house symbolized there was a thief in the house. And she kept torturing her husband every night, saying, hey, there's a thief downstairs. You have to go check downstairs because I'm certain there is a thief. So the husband would go downstairs, check, there is no thief, come back, comfort his wife, says, I checked, no one is there. And this continued night after night, year after year, a decade after decade, until 40 years later, on a regular routine to go check the downstairs for a thief because his wife is spooked. Lo and behold, there's a guy actually with the gun to his face. He got surprised. And the thief says, don't make a noise or I'll shoot you. Give me all of your precious belongings. He says, sir, don't shoot me. Take whatever you need to take. He takes everything. And before the thief leaves, he says, wait. Before you leave, you gotta meet my wife. She's been expecting you for the past 40 years. That's faith. This woman had faith for 40 years that there will be a thief. 40 years she did not see the reality of her faith until on the 40th year that became a reality. See, whether you realize it or not, but that woman was a woman of faith. Unfortunately, she used her faith against herself. Fear is negative faith. Anxiety is negative faith. People who say, oh, it's so hard to believe. Really? It's very easy to be anxious. No. It's same thing as reverse and drive. You choose where you direct your faith toward. You can wake up every morning expecting, it must be cancer. It must be arthritis. A pinky is hurting. It must be something. Or you can wake up every morning and be expectant. This is a good day. Something good is going to happen to me. God is on my side. The angels are guarding me. God's promises are for me. I am handsome, fearfully and wonderfully made. God has a plan and a purpose for my life. And everything that bad that will happen, God will redeem it for good. I am doomed to succeed. Keep saying that for a few years and you will be surprised how your attitude, vision, your words immediately transcend in your life. If you walk around saying things, I'm bald, ugly, and fat, that's exactly what will happen. If you walk around saying, I'm no good, people don't love me, nobody likes me, I am this and that, that's exactly what will happen. If you walk around, I'm retarded, if that's the vision you have, do not be surprised if one day a thief faces you with a gun in your face and says, give me your money. Because according to your faith, it will be done to you. I know that personally from my personal life, I lived most half of my life believing and being convinced I was worthless, believing that I was no good. And if you would look at my physical appearance, you would be saying, I'm not surprised, nor am I. And I had proof to believe for that. I had evidence for my faith. And it's amazing how my faith was working so good, except against me. Everywhere I would meet people, the first question they would ask me, what's wrong with your eyes? How do they know I was thinking of myself as worthless. How did they know that I was constantly thinking of the fact that I am deformed? How do they know? See, when you have faith inside of you, people will feel it. When you have faith inside of you that you know good, people will feel it, and do not be surprised if they treat you according to your faith. And you'll be walking around and say, you gotta stop changing the way you treat me and so that I will then change how I feel. No. Change your faith and people will take care of themselves. And it's amazing when something, come on. And it's amazing what happened with my personal life is that when things on inside started to change, people stopped to care on how I look. Even most of you right now, that is not a distraction. You don't even think, you see beside that. Why? Because the person on inside is confident in who God is, that everything on the outside does not matter. And people immediately catch that. And that then, no limitation becomes your barrier. Why? Because you know who you are and because you have a vision. It's so important that prayer is not just a time where you exercise, recite your negative vision. You replay the worst scenario of what could, what should have, and what might have happened. A prayer is the time where you play a vision. Keep replaying a vision of what God has promised, what God has said, of who you want to be, and what God wants you to become. Then prayer becomes enjoyable. Prayer becomes a routine, not because it's a religion, but because you fellowship with the Holy Spirit who lives inside, and then you tell Him of the faith you want to see in your life. You tell Him of the vision. Remember, if you say you don't have faith, you do. Maybe it's just in against yourself. Switch your faith from reverse to drive and press the pedal to the metal, and you will see where that will take you. Can somebody say amen? With that said, let's open the scriptures to Book of Acts, chapter 11, verse 5 and down. Apostle Peter is explaining to the council of people in Jerusalem about why he visited Cornelius' house. Cornelius was a Gentile. Gentile means he was not a Jewish person. For Israel, it was prohibited to go and spend time and eat with the rest of those people. It's not because they were racist, but because other cultures didn't worship God and they were trying to be pure by staying away from them. And Peter here gives an explanation. I was in the city of Joppa praying, and in a trance, I saw a vision. So we see that Peter was praying, and as he was praying, he had a vision. I saw something like a large sheet being let down from heaven by its four corners. And it came down to where I was. I looked into it and I saw four-footed animals of the earth, wild beasts, reptiles, and birds. However you pronounce that. Perfect. Verse 7. Then I heard a voice telling me, get up, Peter, kill and eat. That just shows that God is not vegetarian. Anyway, keep going. Verse 8. I replied, surely not, Lord. Peter was. Nothing impure or unclean has ever entered my mouth. The voice spoke from heaven a second time, do not call anything impure that God has made clean. This happened three times, and then it was all pulled up to heaven again. Right then, three men who had been sent to me from this city stopped at my house where I was staying, and the Spirit told me to have no hesitation about going with them. These six brothers also went with me, and we entered the man's house. To cut the story short, they came to Cornelius' house. Peter preaches the message. As Peter is talking, Holy Spirit falls in the room. People begin to speak in other languages. God begins to move. He gets them baptized, stays there a few more days, and from that point, Christianity went to your country, my country, and our country. This was the turning point where Christianity broke out of a box of Judaism that it was in for a few years. Now, I want us to take this story and apply it to us. Christianity is not philosophical. Christianity is very practical. If it doesn't rely and apply to your life, then you have to find something is wrong there. Christianity is meant to apply to our life. The message we will title today, The Knocking of Three Men. The Knocking of Three Men. If you can put up the first point. Before the three men will knock on your door, vision will knock on your mind. Before the three men will knock on your door, vision has to knock on your mind. We see something that God takes Peter and he begins to give Peter a new vision in prayer. And this new vision God was giving to him that Peter will need to go outside of the borders of his nation into other nations that Peter wasn't accustomed to. And as God removed the barrier in his mind, something happened. These nations actually started to come to him. He didn't even go there. We understand this principle with God is that God has three men coming to your house. These three men is not Russian, Mexican, and Chinese. These three men is not your brother, your uncle, and your ex. These three men, what I mean by three men is the three, God has blessings on the way to your life. Blessings you haven't experienced, blessings you haven't seen, and God has plans for your life. But for those plans, before they knock on the doors, God goes inside of your mind and begins to mess with it. Because people whose minds God does not stretch, when three men knock, they ignore the knock, thinking it's some strangers knocking on my house. Peter first had to have his mind changed because Peter was in the small cave of just reaching out to Jewish people and his mind was limited just with his people while God wanted him to reach out to the nations. But he knew Peter will not go to the nations if first Peter's mind does not go to the nations. Before men could knock on the door, God has to knock on your mind. If God is knocking on your mind, that means there is already men on the way. When you're sick and you're praying and God is begins to deal with you and say, you can't have a sick mindset. Meaning, you can't constantly walk around saying, I am sick. You have to say, I am healthy, fighting sickness. You can't walk around saying, I'm weak. You have to say, I am strong, fighting weakness. You can't walk around and say, I am rejected. Nobody loves you. You have to walk around and say, I am accepted. I am well loved. Happened to fight a rejection right now. What that happens is that your mind fills with the promises of God. And then on the bottom of the house, there could be knocking. Many people wait for people to knock on your house before you let God knock on your mind. Many of us tell God, Lord God, you can knock on my house if you fix my car. The reason why I'm depressed, well, I have him and her and them to answer for. You change him, them, and then I will be very happy. God says, I will make you happy. And because I make you happy, three of them will knock on the door and make you more happy. First, God changes your mind. And then he changes the things that happen outside of it, not the other way around. Number two. We see in this scripture that which is on the great sheet is already on the way to you. That which is on the great sheet is already on its way to you. God shows Peter a dream. In this dream, there is a sheet that comes down. There is this blanket that comes down from heaven. And this blanket has four corners. And the Bible says in this blanket is all kinds of exotic animals. They symbolized nations and continents. And God shows that to Peter. And Peter is looking and said, wow. But Peter did not know. These nations were already making way to his house. God was showing him something, not that he's going to do. He's already done it. God was telling Peter, last night, I already talked to Cornelius. Cornelius already sent the man, and I'm just giving you a heads up. This vision I'm showing you, it's not something I'm gonna do later. It's something I already have done. It's on its way to your house. Change your mind. Hurry up, Peter. Every vision God will give us, it's not something God wants to do. It's something he already has done. When someone gets a vision of healing, they're sick. They're filled with doctor's report. They're filled with their symptoms. They're filled with medicine. They're filled with pain. They're filled with sleepless nights. And you begin to pray and God begins to say, well, you have to see yourself that everything is going to be okay. Everything will be okay. You're like, well, God, are you going to do it? And God's answer is this. It was 2,000 years ago that my son took that disease. So the answer is no, I am not going to do it. I have done it. When you're defeated by an addiction and you just literally, you take two steps forward, three steps backwards, and you're praying and you're so defeated, you already know you're gonna stop. You're gonna quit. You know you're gonna stumble into that again. And you're praying and you say, God, set me free. And God says, you gotta change your vision. You can't see yourself as a constant loser. But Lord, does that mean that you're going to defeat the devil? No, I am not going to defeat the devil. I have defeated him 2,000 years ago. The vision God gives you is not something he is going to do. It's something he's already done. Peter, this sheet is not something that's gonna happen. It's already has happened and it's on its way to you. When someone is in the curse of poverty, meaning in the blessed country of United States, where you work full time, where all of the opportunities are against you, but you live from hand to mouth, the Bible calls that curse. Doesn't mean you're a bad person. It just simply means you realize there's something holding you back. And you begin to see yourself a blessed person as you pray. You say, God bless me. And God begins to change your image. You say, you cannot see yourself as broke, busted, and disgusted. You got to see yourself as a person that God is going to bless. God is going to provide for your needs. And you say, Lord, does that mean you're going to do that? God says, no. I already have done it. On the cross, my son was accursed that you will receive the blessing of Abraham. Blessing is not stuff, toys and cars and houses. Blessing is God's favor pushes you to have more than enough so you can share with others who don't. Can someone say amen? Amen. There was one woman in South Korea who had cancer in her throat and she couldn't speak because of this cancer. She came to her pastor for prayer. The pastor prayed for her and nothing happened. She came again. The pastor prayed for her. Nothing happened. She started to bother the pastor, and not necessarily because she had cancer, but she always told the pastor after prayer, I know you prayed, pastor, but the demon in my throat is so much bigger than God inside of your heart. So this pastor was really upset. And lo and behold, she comes again to him to ask, could you, pastor, pray for me? And he was so mad at her. So he said, no, I am not going to pray for you. This time, I'm going to send you to a prayer mountain, and you need to go there, and with a notebook, you need to write this scripture 10,000 times. What it says, by his stripes we were healed. And after you write one time, you need to get up and speak it loud. By his stripes we were healed. And after you write that 10,000 times, you come, then I pray for you. So lo and behold, a week later, this woman runs into the office, hits through the door, says, pastor, now you gotta pray for me. Brings this notebook, there's 10,000 times of the same verse. He said, I didn't think you would do it. She says, pastor, I did it. He said, hey, I've noticed. How is your voice doing? He said, yeah, that is true. He said, pastor, it's doing so much better. He said, what happened? She said, I didn't even realize. When I was writing this by his stripes, I was healed. My voice came back, goes back to the doctor and realizes she has no throat cancer whatsoever. See, while she had the vision by saying God's word to herself, she didn't know. Healing is not something God is going to do. He has done it and it was on its way to her, ready to knock, and it entered in. God wants to bring changes in your life, but it first happens by changes happening here. God gives you a vision. God gives you a vision of who you're supposed to be. It looks completely contrary to what you see today. You receive that vision, and that vision, it's not something God is going to do. It's already done. But it's gonna happen in your life. Can somebody say amen? Amen. Point number three. Vision is not just something you see. It's also something you have to eat. Vision is not something you see. It's something we have to eat. Meaning it has to become real. See, God presents this vision to Peter and says, do you see these exotic animals? This symbolized four corners of the earth. This symbolized nations. This symbolized Asia. This symbolized Latin America. This symbolized Russia. This symbolized India, Africa. This symbolized that. And Peter's like, amazing, amazing, impressive. Until God goes a step further. He says, Peter, start eating it. No. Vegetarian. Don't eat those things. They're really nice to look at, but I'm not sure how they're gonna taste. See, many of us love visions, but we don't want to make them a reality inside. We love to think about them when good things happen, but to adopt that image inside, for you to walk with inside, that's when we say, no, that is not for me. No, I will look at it, but I will not eat it. God wants you to have that image inside of you today. Not when it happens, when he says it. There was one young man named David. He was a shepherd boy. And the prophet Samuel comes with a jar of oil to anoint a next king of Israel. Finds this big studs who were the brothers of David. Who were handsome, tough, buff. They worked out at Gold's Gym. I mean, they had it going for them. And there comes this little corny, this little David. I didn't have his abs. He didn't even have a gym membership. He didn't work out a lot. He smelled like sheep. He was so quiet. And the prophet comes on him and he says, this good-looking young boy is going to be the next king of Israel. And the prophet pours oil on his head. I want you to notice where he pours oil on. Head. When did David become a king? When they put a crown on his head or when they put oil on his head? Oil. At the age of a young man, probably 16, 15, being probably on his knees, receiving oil on his head, you know what else David received in his mind? I'm a king. Nobody believed he was a king except a prophet. And David. From that day, David's life changed. You know why? There was no crown, but there was a king inside. Where did the king come from? Oil. When God's word paints an image, and instead of saying, no, Lord, this is too hard, this is too difficult, you say, God, this is awesome, scary, and crazy. But God, let it hit my head. Let it come upon my head. You say, I'm a king? I'm only 15. People will not, there is a king already. How will this work? But God, I like your idea. Let's make me a king. And after that, I'm going back to the sheep. And kings don't go with the sheep. But God, if you call me a king with the sheep, I'm a king with the sheep. And many of us will say, I'm not a king. If I'm a king, they'll invite me to the palace, not to the sheep. David walks around a king. No crown. But a king is inside. And that's what happens when a person becomes healthy on inside, but the pain is still in his ankles. When a person becomes blessed on inside, and their car got repossessed. When a person is blessed on inside, but their boyfriend just walked away and left them, their heart is broken, and walking on inside, I'm a blessed person. I don't have a crown, but I got some oil. You don't become a king when you get crowned. You become a king when you get anointed. You don't become who you are when you become that. You become who you are when God says it, you believe it. And then it takes time for circumstances to catch up. That's why the Bible says we don't have to just see the vision, eat it. You make that vision a part of you. You receive that vision in Jesus' name. Amen. Some of you don't know, but for the longest part in our youth ministry, in our church, on Wednesday nights, we could never break in attendance-wise, we could never break 70. 65, 70 was like revival. When we hit 80, whew, that was powerful revival. That means God moved, even if nothing happened, but we just had 80 people. For the longest, for 10 years of our ministry, we never had more than 80 people, maybe once in a long while. Last year, after summer, I remember this Sunday morning, we were praying here, and as we're praying for God to move, we're praying for souls to be saved. And in this prayer, God starts to present a vision inside of my spirit where I have to see this sanctuary filled. today. And I was like, well, God, there's no way they could be filled on Wednesday. This has never happened in 10 years. Plus, I mean, we're not those kind of people. And as I began to see the vision, not only that vision, but the Holy Spirit started to put in my heart that I need to change things that Wednesday. And some of those things was this, is that instead of people sitting on this side, which is something that has happened for 10 years, to have people sit on both sides. I was like, well, God, if we sit on both sides, there's going to be 1.5 pew filled. I'm going to be discouraged. People will be discouraged. And you're going to be discouraged. We're all going to be discouraged. And I remember that Wednesday we sat down, put the pulpit in the middle, and we were still leaning toward this side all the time. Because, you know, all paths don't die really fast. And it took a while. And the interesting part is, so it had been some months that our attendance every Wednesday has not dropped under 100. What happens? God first presents a vision. You believe in that vision. And people come. Now we're still inviting the same way we were inviting before. But and now I started to act different. Not as a pastor of just a small group, a small little club. But you have to act now differently. I became that person on that prayer. And it just takes time for the crown to come. First comes the oil, then comes the crown. But most of you, you're like, God, give me the crown. Oh, Jesus, give me the crown. When God comes with oil, it's like, keep the oil to yourself. Give me the crown. No. God first will give you the oil, and then the oil will bring the crown. He gives you the revelation. He gives you the vision. He gives you the hope inside. You grab it, and then comes the reality, not the other way around. Can somebody say amen? In the conclusion, let me share with you a few practical tips on how this vision could become a reality. Write down the practical tips. Because sometimes we hear a theory, but let's make it something practical. One, new vision at first will produce painful discomfort. Why will the new vision produce painful discomfort? Just like you see in this image, a cat is looking in the mirror and he sees a lion. New vision is you will see yourself in prayer. You close your eyes and you see yourself a lion. You open your eyes and you're a little cat. And you become discomfortable. You become uncomfortable. And so it's easier either to keep your eyes closed or to keep them open and never to close them again. Many people, when they begin to have visions, because visions conflict with their reality, and when there is a conflict, your mind begins to suffer. Meaning your mind begins to be discomforted. And when there is no comfort there, many times we love comfort so much that we're willing to sacrifice our future, our destiny, our potential, and our calling on the bed of comfort. When God says to Peter, Peter, I see nations and continents. The first thing that Peter said, he didn't say, yes, God, I've been praying about it. He said, no, Lord, never gonna happen. The population of Israel, Jewish people in the world today, is about 6 million people. The population of the globe is about 7 billion. Now, I don't know exactly how much the population was 2,000 years ago, but let's assume for a moment. Here is a man whose target area is 6 million people. That's a lot. Peter has become known. Peter has been raising the dead. Peter's shadow has been healing people. Peter's been preaching. Peter's been in prison and got out of prison. Not because his homies and cronies got him out, but because Jesus through angels got him out. Peter has got a good resume, amazing apostle, preaches everything, doing good in a small little circle of 6 million people. And God says, Peter, but I called you for the whole earth, not just for a little nest. And when God showed him the picture of the whole earth, it fried his mind. It started to hurt. Your mind is like a rubber band. Its usefulness is only in its ability to be stretched. When your mind doesn't stretch, it's useless. Even if you have PhDs, masters, and bachelors. If your mind is stuck, not able to stretch over what you known, tried, didn't happen. If you cannot stretch it, you maybe come in and some of you, your mind was fried during worship. You're like, why are these people screaming? Why are they raising their hands? Your mind was being stretched. For us, that's no longer a problem. First time when I heard people jumping, my mind fried. I was like, this is not from God. Only people in the world do this. First time I saw people who were girls and they were wearing makeup, I said, this is definitely not from God, because Christian girls should never wear makeup. They shouldn't have enough money to wear makeup in the first place. My mind was stretched. But today my mind is completely comfortable with these things. But God is challenging me and is challenging you in some other areas where your mind is gonna feel like it's being fried. And it's completely normal. It's only for a little bit. Because the comforts you're accustomed to, you're about to sacrifice to experience the comforts you don't even know exist. When a little eaglet is in the nest, the little eaglet thinks, the little eaglet knows everything about the world because the feathers are there. It's a small little circle, and that's exactly what Peter was in. The feathers, mama feeds you, and until mama tells, hey, listen, your wings are big enough, you need to not live like a chicken walking around. You gotta soar, you gotta explore the world. And like, no, I like this. This is so safe. I never get hurt here. Everything is so comfortable here. And the mama sees that the little eaglet needs to step out, and it begins to stretch their mind by removing their feathers. Creates a wind until all the feathers out of the nest fly out, and the little eaglets begin to poke their tender legs on the sharp branches, and the little eaglets have no other choice but to leave the comfort of their nest and experience a new comfort they never even imagined existed. See, some of you are comfortable with the level that you are in. Some people actually get comfortable being miserable. Some people get comfortable being addicted. Some people get comfortable being abused. You look at you like, how could you be? I don't like it, but it's familiar. We do that in our country. Everybody has this disease. People criticize George Bush. George Bush, such a bad president. When he came for election, voted for him again. Barack Obama, such a bad president. It came for the election. Who are you going to vote for? Barack Obama. Why? Because comfortable. We know it's predictable. We're familiar with it. And we do that with our life all the time. Whether it's good or bad, because I've been it, I've done it, I know it's comfortable, and it's something new, it's scary, it's risky, and God is coming to Peter and say, Peter, this new vision will make one thing. You're gonna have to pay a price, not in dollars, not in gold. You will have to sacrifice a comfort for a little bit until you taste a new comfort. You don't know what you're talking even about. Can somebody say amen? Second tip, you can't give up on your vision. You can't give up on your vision. Your vision is something you gotta hold on all the time. When God gives vision to Peter, we see something that God not only says, Peter, I know this is not comfortable, but God says this vision to Peter brings it three times. Somebody said three times. God brings it once, second time, third time. It became so consistent that after Peter left the vision and they were eating, the Bible says Peter was still thinking about the vision. One of the reasons why many visions die is because a vision, what we don't understand about a vision is this. You need vision for you. But the vision needs you also. The same way a baby inside of the mother's womb needs a mother. We don't think of this sometimes. The vision God gives you needs you. If you don't give it strength by holding on to it, it will die. Tatiana is pregnant. How many months? 5 months. She has a baby inside. This baby you don't see. She feels that. She feeds this baby, not realizing it. How she feeds the baby? By carrying this baby and protecting this baby. If at some time she says, this baby is a hindrance to my life, this baby is a hindrance to my schedule, this baby is a hindrance to my appearance, and I can no longer carry this baby, I just need to let this baby, give this baby somewhere else so this baby can grow on its own, and then once it grows, it can come back into my life. How many of you know that the baby will die the first day the baby will leave her womb? Why? Because though Tatiana needs the baby needs Tatiana. The Bible says people without vision perish. That means people can have money, people can have a family, but if they don't have a vision and purpose, their life loses meaning. But did you know that visions without people also perish? You know, visions cannot become reality without people. You know, vision is looking for a womb. Vision says, I can make you somebody great. I can change your life. Could I borrow your womb? Could you not kick me out when things get hard? Could you not throw me on the curb because you face an obstacle? Could you please feed me? One day I'll feed you, I'll change you. But when things get hard, please don't abort me. And many of us, that's exactly what we do. We believe for something one time, believe for something second time, but God wants to make it happen three times. It means He wants it to get sealed and stick inside of you. And not just something that you have, but eventually something that has you. You gotta feed it. You gotta hold on to it. And just because things are tough, just because things are a little bit obstacles on your way, you cannot simply throw that on the curb and saying, my life is just too hard. I'm just too difficult to visit. No. Your vision needs you. Your vision is waiting on you to give it food. And one day, when you feed it, it will feed you. It will change things around you. Because it's going to be God who's going to work through that vision. Because that's going to be faith. Can somebody say amen? The last tip. The Holy Spirit will guide a person of vision. When Peter's vision came three times, it stuck to him and something happened. We see in the Bible that the moment there was a knock on the door, the three men symbolize opportunity. When there was an opportunity knocking on the door, the Holy Spirit in that moment said to Peter, your turn. People always ask me, well, I'm believing that I'm going to be financially free. I'm believing I am going to be healed. I'm believing that my home group is going to grow. But Vlad, how? This is how. A person who has a vision that grows inside of him, comes a moment when opportunity knocks. People without vision don't hear it because opportunities usually are dressed like adversities. And because they're dressed like obstacles, we run away from them. They're dressed like strangers. You don't recognize their voice. Only the people who have a vision inside. This is from God. Another person will say, these are strangers, run. People without vision miss the knocking of three men. And they always say, God, why are you not sending a miracle? See, God sends a miracle, but it's your vision inside that you keep that helps you to recognize the knocking of three men. Helps you recognize financial response, financial dealings. Help you to recognize deals that other people will say, this will not work, this will fail. And you say, man, this will work. The Holy Spirit speaks to the person of vision. If you're not a person of vision, Holy Spirit cannot speak to you about opportunities. You will miss opportunities. Opportunities don't happen to lucky people. Opportunities happen to people who are in prayer saying, God, give me a new vision. Who hold on to that when things are tough. And when opportunity presents, those people usually take advantage of those opportunities. Can somebody say amen? There was a man named Edwin Barnes. Some 100 years ago, he had this dream that he wanted to partner with Thomas Edison. And he wanted to work with Thomas Edison. The only problem with this man is two problems. If you can go back to the picture. This man had two problems. One of them, he did not know Thomas Edison. Number two, he was so poor, he didn't even have enough money to buy a train ticket to go see Thomas Edison in New Jersey. Two big problems. But he was convinced he will partner with Thomas Edison. Another problem was that this guy was not smart. Thomas Edison was. Thomas Edison doesn't partner with stupid people. Thomas Edison is very intelligent. He's a science guy. He creates things, invents things. And if you don't, you're not going to partner with Thomas Edison. But this young man had a vision. I am going to partner with Thomas Edison. Buys a ticket, finds some money, goes to where Thomas Edison is. Schedules an interview with Thomas Edison. When he comes to meet Thomas Edison, he looks like he comes from the streets. He looks like he has nothing. And Thomas Edison looked at him, and actually, I'm just going to read to you exactly what Thomas Edison said. He said, he stood there before me looking like an ordinary Trump, but there was something in the expression of his face which conveyed the impression that he was determined to get what he came after. I had learned from years of experience with men, when a man really desires a thing so deeply that he is willing to stake his entire future on a single turn of a wheel in order to get it, he is sure to win. I gave him an opportunity he asked for, because I saw he had made up his mind to stand by until he succeeded. Synchronic events proved that no mistake was made. But this is what happened. Thomas Edison hired him as a janitor. Somebody can say, well, my dream came to pass. I partnered with Thomas Edison. But his dream was not to work as a janitor for Thomas Edison, to partner with Thomas Edison. He worked as a janitor for Thomas Edison 5 years. In those times, he would pay close attention to Thomas Edison, how he walked, how he dressed, what ticked him off, happy moments, bad moments. I mean, he was like a sponge mopping the floors, but he always had his eyes on Thomas Edison. People worked with Thomas Edison for a long time who never partnered with him. Here is a janitor mopping floors, still has a dream. I didn't come here to mop floors for him. I came here to partner with him. Until Thomas Edison, if you can show the picture, releases a machine. It's called the Edison dictating machine. He releases that machine and none of his sales guys believe this machine can lift the ground. It means they don't believe this machine will sell. In the business meeting, they all start one by one saying, Edison, you're a great guy. This is your mistake. It won't sell, we won't sell it. This mopper guy went there to mop the floor and overheard how they said they can't sell it. But Thomas Edison already made plenty of them. When everyone left, he comes to him and he says, sir, would you give me an opportunity? A little try, give me just a little time so that I can sell that machine that everyone said it won't sell. Thomas Edison says, since I have to throw it away, I will let you do it. This man sells that machine like he will sell his life. He does it so passionately, does it so enthusiastically. He sells all of the machines Thomas Edison had until Thomas Edison made him a partner and the only distributor of these machines in the United States of America. In a very short time, this man became a multimillionaire. Thus, his dream became a reality. Why? Man had a vision, refused to give up when obstacles came, and intuition kicked in. It's interesting. All the co-workers did not get an idea to sell this machine when it wasn't selling. Only one guy in that building. You know who that guy was? Not the most smartest guy, not the most handsome guy, the guy with the vision. You know how you're not gonna miss your opportunities? If you have a vision inside of you before they come. When they will knock, if the vision is inside, you'll hear the knock, not as a stranger, as a friend. Other people will hear the knock and say, we should run away. You will hear the knock and say, I gotta open the door. And you will enter into the reality of your dream, of your vision. Can somebody say amen? Christian life should not be about rules and regulations. It's supposed to be about dreams and visions, working with God and with the Holy Spirit. My friends, these are not fairy tales I'm telling you from 90s. These are the truths from the Bible, from the God's Word. Visions and dreams, you already have them. The question is, what kind of visions and dreams? Worthless, bad, sick, my kids are acting up, my wife is crazy, my husband is crazy, my boss is crazy, my work is crazy, everything is crazy, and at the end, I'm crazy. That's a bad vision. Change your vision. God will change your